Jesus, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Yes, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Please share when you come on. I'm trying to share to all of our pages. Hey, Corrine, good morning. Hey, Miranda, Felicia Harris. Y'all, I'm truly going to be on 30 minutes a day. I'm going to try to practice 30 minutes a day because I'm ministering every single day. And it's taking a lot of strength out of you. Good morning, Teresa. So my goal is 30 minutes today. We're going to pray and however God want me to do in 30 minutes. I need y'all to keep the time for me. I'm going to keep looking at my watch if y'all see me doing that. Because I know y'all have a busy day, and I don't want to take away from y'all's day by being on an hour and a half and all this stuff like that. I'm just coming to agree with you, to pray, and to give you some good morning, everyone, if you need me to. I can remind. Okay, yes, remind me at 30 minutes, please. It takes a lot ministering every day. I never ministered every day. It takes a lot out of you. By the time I'm done, I'm just like gone, you know. Hey, Joe. I'm like gone. Like, I don't have no energy to do anything. Amen, amen, amen. We're going to come to my, I have a prayer I want us to read together. So, or you can listen to me, or you can repeat after me, whatever. But I'm not going to do that right now. I want to talk about holiness. And I think we read the scripture, I think, last week. Who shall ascend? When do you want the time to start? Clearly, my timer is unreliable. We better depend on Miranda, because I don't kick. Yeah, I remember yesterday. We were depend. The time starts now, Miranda. Right now, at the moment. Like, right now. Let me know when 30 minutes is up. Who shall ascend into the hills of the Lord, and who shall stand in the holy place? Who have clean hands and a pure heart, and who has not lifted up his soul to vanity, nor swore deceitfulness? Who shall receive the blessings from the Lord, and righteousness from the God of his salvation? And also in 1 John 3:8, it talks about he that committed sin is of the devil, and things like that. So I want to talk about holiness and how to keep your house free of sin. You know, the scripture says, it's me in my house, we shall serve the Lord, and making sure everyone is lined up, because one person in the house can cause the enemy to come in. You want to make sure every door is shut, every window is sealed, there's no cracks, because it can take one person that's in your home to cause the enemy to enter in. It doesn't matter how he enters in. I remember when we were growing up, they used to always tell us, and that's why my mom and dad was very strict. We couldn't wear pants, makeup. You know, we were raised in Church of Christ. And we had, oh my God, our curfew was like, I was spoiled, so I got away with a lot of things. But they gave us strict curfews and little things we couldn't do. We couldn't go to the prom, things like that. And I really didn't understand what they were doing. And what they was doing is, if when your kids leave your house, come back in, leave your house, come back in, that they get, their spirits are attached to different things they do. And you didn't pray your whole house, you know, and anoint your house. And then your kid is doing whatever they want to do. And they come in, they're bringing in something from wherever they came from. And I didn't understand why my mom and dad were so strict. And now that I'm grown, I do understand. You have to watch what comes into your house. Because you can be praying all you want to. But if you're not tapping to the spirit as the head of the house or as the parents, and discern what's going on and what's going in at your house, your kids can bring something in that, you know, and you wonder why you're arguing and fighting, your husband and wife is arguing and fighting, and you wonder why you're going through some of the things you're going through, because, you know, you got everybody going in and at your house, and you got to be careful who is in your house and who you let in your house. Your house is supposed to be your safe haven. It's supposed to be a place of rest and a place of peace. But we're allowing everybody and anybody. I know a lady pastor, and including me, when I used to go to her house, if I could go in her house, she had an oil at the door, and she would anoint my hands, my feet, my head. She don't care who I was. She, because she knew me, she didn't care. All she knew, I have children in my home, and I have to protect my home. So anybody who came to home, she had to pray over them first, because she said, listen, she was a single woman, and she was by herself. And she said, I can't take a chance of allowing something to come in my house, even if I know you. I don't know you like that. And I have to understand, and you have to understand that don't take it personal, but this is my home, and my home is sacred, and I got to make sure I know what's going in and out. Now, people who allow people to go in and out their house, that is not a good thing. Your house is supposed to be your safe haven. And you're supposed to make sure that your house is pure and clean, especially if you have children. I mean, you know, your kid, you know, a lot of times, you know, when we were young, our mama trusted us to go to our friend's house. You know, we did not go to the place that we said we was going. And they trust us that we was going to go to a clean environment. And most of the time we didn't. We told our mom we was going to, you know, one thing I did do, we couldn't wear pants, but I put pants in my purse. And I would go somewhere and put the pants on. And then by the time I get back home, I'll take it off. Well, I'll sneak and have makeup in my purse. And I'll have my makeup on when I'm at wherever I'm at. But when I got home, I took the makeup off, you know, so I wouldn't get caught. But of course, I did get caught a few times and got in trouble. But my mom, it was making sure that the house was peaceful, clean. I mean, you gotta know what's in your house. That's your house. That's your place of serenity, and that's your place. And so you should be able to allow or not allow whatever comes in, whatever comes out your home. And a lot of times when we struggle in prayer, you gotta make sure what's in your environment. A lot of times we meet people places. We don't allow everybody to come into our environment. Like, even though we stay right here, we have a section of a church that we stay in. We don't let anybody, very few people, go in that section of you know, that part of where we sleep or where we stay, because that is our place. And any atmospheres or spirits that's operating, we decree that they are expelled and they're gone, and that place is the house of peace and joy. But if you ever find out that, wonder why you were arguing with your kid for no reason, or your kid is acting kind of weird and kind of funny, you got to find out and discern what is in your house. And you have to, every night, like I told you a couple of weeks ago, with my dad every night covered our house with oil, covered the windows, covered the door, and he covered, even if we were standing in the way, we got anointed. But then we prayed as a family. My mom had a California, what's it called, big bed. It's just bigger than a king size bed, and we were a queen size bed, king size bed. And we would gather around the bed and join hands. And every night we would have prayer to make sure that the devil wouldn't torment our minds and the devil wouldn't get into our dreams. And then we had conversations. And then we had Bible study. Then we had talks. So they did everything to make sure our house was pure and our house is holy. So there's times when you find yourself, you know, you wonder, like, something's going on. I don't know why I feel the way I do. Something is tormenting my mind, and I don't understand that. Is you have to clear your home, and that's your safe haven. Everybody cannot, you can't allow everybody in your home. A lot of times my husband answers the door, he don't bring people in. He go outside with them and talk with them outside. Because you don't know what people are bringing in your home. Then you got to understand what gifts you're taking from people. You don't know what people are doing. If you want to take a gift from somebody, you make sure you pray over that gift, or pray over whatever someone's handing to you. I used to tell people, I know there's people engaged and people that are getting married, and they got their ring from a pawn shop. There's nothing wrong with a pawn shop, but you got to make sure that spirits ride on things. Spirits have that ring had a past, and that person who pawned that ring might have been in a divorce or something, whatever. I don't know why they pawned the ring, but you don't put that ring on your finger. You take that ring and anoint it with oil. You take that ring and pray over it. You take that ring and rebuke every spirit, every past thing of this ring, whatever is on this ring. Because when you put that ring on your finger, you're putting whatever that last part. Y'all, I go deep with stuff. I'm telling you, one day I bought a couch one day. And I don't like used things, not because I am bougie, whatever they may call it, nothing like that. it's just, I don't like used things. And for purpose of, I had to always explain myself years after year about why I don't. It's not like I'm too good for used things. It's I just understand that stuff is on things. I don't know who been on that couch. I don't know what they did on the couch. And I don't know, you know, one day we got a couch and we prayed over the couch. My husband cleaned the couch. He did everything he could, but I couldn't sit on that couch for 3 years. You know, I had to make sure that that couch was purified on the last person that was on that couch. I don't like used clothes. I don't like I said, not that I'm bougie, anything like that. Of course, people say I am. My husband right now, he gonna beg the different. But you gotta be careful on what you bring in your house. And if you are using used furniture, you wanna get your engagement ring or whatever from pawn shop, just make sure that you pray over it and you anoint it and you're making sure that you are not bringing anything in your house that's foreign to you, especially if you're not to the place of seeking God, to the place where you can discern and know, okay, when you put that ring in your hand or you put that couch in your house, you feel something strange or you feel something funny, that, okay, I bind that devil, that spirit that was operating on the last person that was in this home, I bind that spirit in the name of Jesus, and I am not going to allow this spirit to be in my home, and I'm making sure that that there is no crack. See, the enemy is very cunning, and he knew you needed a new couch, and he going to send you to the wrong one, you know, which to you is the right one, and that's why I said seeking God opens your mind and your spirit to things, to spirits, to you ask God, what couch should I pick? If you can afford a new couch, please get a new one. And I'm not saying the new couch ain't free of anything either. I'm just, hey, listen, whatever you bring in your home, you got to pray, you got to cover it, you got to plead the blood, and you got to know that you're not bringing the wrong things in your house. And be careful too, like I said a few minutes ago, of taking gifts from people. You gotta really be careful of that too. Because people, they say they're your friends, but sometimes they're your enemies, you know, behind your back. And you don't know, they may be jealous of what you have, a car you drive, and you don't know what they did, what they have done, or anything. And they giving you gifts, smiling your face, but that gift is a token from the devil. And then you bringing things into your home, and you putting it around your neck. Come on, we really guard our children when they come home with stuff. You know, when kids at school, they trade things. I don't know if anybody on here kids did that, where they trade things and they trade shoes. I never understood that part. You take my shoes this week and I'll take your shoes this week. And then you wonder why all of a sudden whatever spirit was in that home is attacking your home. So you have to be careful. I'm not saying be all in bondage, but be conscious of what you're doing and be conscious of what you're bringing in. I mean, you got enough things going on with your own self that you're trying to ask God to open you up and purify you and heal you and sanctify you and cleanse you. You got enough stuff that you're dealing with yourself, and you don't need to be dealing with someone else's issues and problems. And we got to be conscious of used furniture, used cars. I always tell my kids when they were little, and they would ask to borrow my car, and I used to tell them, y'all, listen, my car is saved, sanctified, and filled with the Holy Ghost, and if you do something out of the will of God in my car, something going to happen. I think one of my kids did borrow my car, and they went to a place they wasn't supposed to, and they got a flat tire, or something like that happened, where they couldn't get to where they was going. It was something like that. You know, so I told my kids, listen, my car is holy. My car, listen, if you do anything outside of God, my car is just going to shut down. And I train my kids to understand that, to know that, man, if you're borrowing my property, you got to be careful with it, because my property is not going to go into the wrong hands, into the wrong places. And you got to watch everything that you do is being conscious in the spirit and allowing God to be, you know, when you're seeking God, you will discern. He will tell you. He will show you things. Because remember, we talked about the last 2 days. God knows the beginning and he knows the end. And just because stuff look good to you right now, but God knows what the end, what's going to happen at the end. He knows it's going to happen a year or 2 years from now. So we really have to be conscious of everything that we do. Make your house a safe place. Come on, don't be inviting any and everybody into your home. Come on, unless you're in ministry. But that's another thing. If you're in ministry, is we had a big 5,000 square foot home, and we use our home for ministry. But when we brought brought them in, we covered them. We covered ourselves. We covered our children by the blood of Jesus. And we had the angels of God to protect us and cover us and making sure that everything that we touch, God, because we in ministry, God, you know, and spirits ride on people. And we want to make sure that what's on them is not contaminating our home or touching our children. Watch the places that you go, because you can carry it, the spirits can ride on you too. Watch the places you go and things you do. For one thing, as a saved person, you should not be walking in a club, you know. Now, unless you, that's another part of ministry that my husband will talk about eventually, because my husband will walk in a club, but you know, as far as ministry, you'll walk in a car and go to the bar and talk to the person behind the bar. Well, that's his ministry. He can do that, and it's not going to lure him in, not going to affect him. So you got to know where you are and making sure that you are delivered and set free, and making sure when you go on the devil's camp or the enemy's camp, and making sure you're covered by the blood. But one thing I didn't notice about my pastor, I went with him. I was afraid, but you know, I was kind of new at you know, being, you know, I was in church, got in Christ, and we didn't do anything. We couldn't do nothing. So when it come to the real world, we was really afraid. You know, we didn't know, we won't go in there, but wasn't taught a lot of things. But when my husband went to a club one time, and this wasn't a club, this is one of those, what do you call those, bucket type place? It wasn't really a club, it was a place where people smoke weed and crack cocaine, and they have little apartments there where they stay there. Well, my husband, we'll walk in there, into that place, and it's like everybody stopped. Those who were drinking put their drinks down. Those that were smoking put their cigarettes down, because when they know, when we walk in darkness, light shows up. And when we walked in the door, they knew who we were even before we didn't have to say anything. And then it's like the Holy Spirit put them under I don't want to use the word spell, because that's a wrong word, but it put them in like in a trance mode, where anything we said, they did. And we said, dude, we're going to gather hands, and we're going to all come together, and we're going to pray. And everybody got up and came in a room, and everybody obeyed, because they were rested in the spirit, and the power of God took over that place in that room. Now, listen, if you go on the devil's camp, make sure that you're full of the Holy Ghost, and make sure that you are led by the Spirit. And you know, yeah, listen, those that are led by the Spirit are sons of God. Those that are led by the Spirit are doing the things that God's called them to. Those that are led by the Spirit are the ones that God is really powerful, protects them. He guards them. He teaches them. He shows them what to do. You have discerning, you have insight, and you have understanding, but you have to be led by the Spirit. Come on, you just can't just do anything without God unctioning you or putting a mantle or a level of power on you to do that. Everybody's not called to everything. And if you want to experience something like that, then go with somebody who has that anointing. You feel that anointing on your life, don't go by yourself. Make sure you go with somebody that can help you and teach you and walk you through to that level. But it's a prayer that I want to pray. That's what, and I love the scripture about living a life of holiness, to the point of, we talked about for the last 2 days, of seeking God with our whole heart and seeking God with our whole mind, and praying in the Holy Ghost, and praying in the Spirit, so you can get the mysteries and the secrets and the things that your eyes will see and your ears will hear that you would normally hear unless you in the presence of the Lord. Come on, we got to be in the presence of the Lord. Come on, with us fullness of great joy and pleasures forevermore. We got to be in the presence of God so we can discern and we can see it. And we won't be ignorant of the devil's devices, and we won't fall into traps, and we won't fall into sin, because sin is taking us out of the will of God, and it's taking us into the devil's territory, where the devil can pluck you out and mess with you and defeat you. And you don't want to be defeated by the enemy. You want to always be purified. You want to always be holy. You want to always be sanctified, and you want to always be in the will of God, and making sure you're not doing something because it's a good thing, but making sure you're doing because you're called to it. Come on. And then don't put no levels of mantles or no no titles on you that was not called by God. You know, the mouth of two or three witnesses, God gives counsel, he gives clarity. And what you need to do before you even put a title before your name, come on, titles come with demonic forces. The titles come with demonic spirits. And if you claim a title, I'm just trying to tell you about the things that can cause you to be in out the will of God, and you don't want to be in a place where you're being defeated by the enemy. You want to make sure you're purified and you're holy and you're spiritual conscious and got your five spiritual senses along with your five natural senses, and know that where God calls you, he calls you. If he didn't call you, don't go on the territory you're not called to, because you can bring that back to your house and it can backfire on you, and you can be wondering why you're sick and why you're going through things, because you opened the door to the enemy and allowed him to come in and steal your spoils and steal your goods. Amen. Now, I'm just, we're going to be 30 minutes a day, not an hour and a half. I want us to pray this prayer. It's a prophetic declaration over your home. And I'm going to try to do it slow where you can repeat after me to make sure our home is clean and making sure, because we're talking about seeking God and we're talking about going to a secret place. And we're talking about getting to the point where we hear and the point that where we see, and making sure there's nothing, no distractions and nothing hinder us from being in the will of God. No spirits, no spirits is illegal in your home. Those spirits is not supposed to be there, and making sure you're conscious of your environment, you're conscious of your surrounding, you're conscious of what's going on in the spirit as well as in the natural. It's the same thing what you do when you carry, you making sure you have a weapon around you, so any strangers or anybody come to your house, you have something that a gun or some kind of weapon to making sure that your family is safe. Well, it's the same thing in the spirit. You got to always, making sure that every defiled spirit, every demonic force has been cast out of this house. We're making sure this house is purified and this house is holy before God. So I want to read this prayer real quick. And I want us to, and I'm gonna read it slow so you can repeat after me. But I'm gonna read a scripture first. So before we get to the prayer points, a confession scripture. And those who have this book is on chapter 15, Joshua 24 and 15. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. That's what I have up in my prayer room. When I told you yesterday that I have my prayer room and I have some little pretty rocks, and then I have all my family. And whoever God is leading me to put on the wall is on the wall of my prayer room, and those I cover. And then there's a scripture on top of that. It says in Joshua 24 and 15. Y'all, I talk real fast. I'm working on slowing down. I didn't even hear myself talking fast. It says Joshua 24 and 15. It says, "For me and my house, we will serve the Lord." That's putting the command. They said, we will serve the Lord. That means we put the command, and we're saying, "The devil, you're not having no place here, and we're not allowing you. We're disallowing you in our house." That means when we read that scripture, we're commanding that. We're saying that. We're speaking to the atmosphere. As of me and my house, devil, you a liar. Everything's going to line up as me and my house. We're going to serve God no matter what it takes or what we have to do. And let's see what's the other scripture. Okay, let's go ahead to the prayer points. You ready to repeat after me? If you're ready to repeat after me, please put in the comments a repeat after me, because probably after this prayer it probably will be my 30 minutes. Hallelujah. John says, "Be careful what you bring into your..." That is yes. If you don't hear nothing else I say, please be conscious of what you do and what you take from people and gifts and where your children go or even where you go. And when you come in, listen. When you come in, listen, put some oil in your purse, anoint your own self, and make sure before I walk in that door, I'm not bringing anything in the house that, behind me, and that is coming in with me. Okay, Father, I thank you for this house that you have given my family and I to dwell in. I decree that this house is the resting place of angels in the name of Jesus. People from this house shall go forth, kings, princes, presidents, governors, in the name of Jesus. I declare that out of this house, the glory of the Lord shall shine into my neighborhood in the name of Jesus. As the Ark of Covenant, bless the house of Obededom. So shall the presence of Jehovah bless this house in the name of Jesus. As the Lord prepares a table before me in the presence of my enemy, let the table of rest, peace, and joy be in my house in the name of Jesus. I speak prophetically over my house that every wall, roof, piece of plumbing, appliances will be kept in perfect peace and nothing shall break in the name of Jesus. The angels are walking inside and around my house now in the name of Jesus. Every demonic contamination released into my house is dying now in the name of Jesus. As God shut the mouths of the lions for the sake of Daniel, so the same Jehovah will shut the mouths of my enemies in the name of Jesus. Though the walls of Jericho fell by the power of Jehovah, let the same power keep my house from falling in the name of Jesus. Lord Jesus, you are welcome in this house forever. This is your abiding place. Come in and out anytime you want and let your presence fill every room here. Hallelujah. I speak prosperity, health, joy, peace, unity, and laughter over this house in the name of Jesus. Let the tree of Lebanon, like the tree of Lebanon, shall the people in this house flourish in the name of Jesus. I declare that this is the pavilion of the Lord, and blessings shall adorn this house for as long as I live here in the name of Jesus. I speak in the power of God, and I declare that no evil report shall come nigh my dwelling place in the mighty name of Jesus. I speak to the atmosphere of this house. Let any turbulence wanting to rob our peace here be swallowed by the fire in the name of Jesus. I decree that embarrassment shall not be known in this house. I decree that poverty shall not know the address of this house. Sickness shall not come knocking on the door of this house in the name of Jesus. Let the foundation of this house be the foundation of blessings in the name of Jesus. I bless this house in the name of Jesus. Did you enjoy that prayer? That was powerful. It had everything you need to make sure that your house is well fit and prepared for whatever God has for you. Oh my God. And a lot of times we're not. The devil don't want you to understand, and he wants you to be ignorant of his devices, and he wants you to be ignorant of his schemes, and he don't want you to know and have knowledge and wisdom. And that's why every day I pray for wisdom and knowledge and insight. And if I feel anything funny or anything crazy, God, let me understand and know what am I dealing with, and what evil spirit or force is coming against this house, and what you want to do, God, in this house, and what is the devil mad at, and what he's trying to come against our home. So, you know, and you got to pray that every single day. And when you pray these prayers, I'm going to try to see if I can get some of these prayers to y'all. But when you pray these prayers, you got to anoint your house with oil. It's almost like the Israelites, when Moses had to put the blood on the doorpost so the death angel will pass them by. The devil can't get past the blood of Jesus. And when you anoint your doorpost of your house, and when you anoint your windows, you're saying that no thief, no evil spirit, no death angel, and nothing can come against this house. Because right now, this house is a house of prayer. And as for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. And listen, you're not going to stop me from seeking God. You're not going to stop me from getting in the place God has called me to. You will not hinder my money, nothing. You will not hinder my children for being all they supposed to do. You will not bring an argument, confusion, and doubt and fear in our marriage. Our marriage is being clean and not being defeated by the enemy. So we bind every stronghold. Come on, you got to command. You got to walk around and you got to command. And we talked about the warfare, to be aggressively and be violent against the enemy, and not allowing him to steal your spoils, and allowing him to know who is in control and that he is not in control. And sometimes you really got to open your door and you got to kick him out. And you know, he'll try to keep coming in. He's going to keep watching and trying to find every door and every window he can to come in, because he know where you about to go, and he wants to hinder what God's trying to do. Because we're talking on warfare, and we're talking on how not to be defeated, and we're talking about how to seek the Lord with all your whole heart and your whole mind, and we're talking about having a relationship with God. But when we talk about that, the devil gets mad, and he goes and has a meeting and calls his boards together, and he said, listen, this didn't work. Listen, these people are praying. Come on, we got to raise up our little higher, and we got to defeat them a little bit harder, and we got to come against their kids and their children, even their dog, and we got to make sure that we're going to discourage them. But he don't understand. Come on. When we seeking God, we are receiving power from on high. We're receiving power against the enemy, and we declare war against them. We will not die. We won't sit here and die, but we will live and declare the word of God, and we will not be defeated and allow the devil to steal our borders. Oh God, come on, to come against our borders and come against our atmosphere and whatever that he has stole, whatever the canker worms and the palmer worms and the locusts have eaten up. God has given us back double for our trouble. So even devil, what you have stole, I'm getting that back double. So you might have to leave me alone, because I'm gonna ask for triple and I'm gonna keep on going. You might as well leave me alone, because I'm gonna cry loud and spare not. I'm not gonna be ashamed. I'm gonna declare the will of God for this house. As far as me and my house, we will serve the Lord, and we will not be defeated. I don't care what comes. I don't care the wind. I don't care the storm. I don't care what your family go through, inside or outside. You got to command peace. You got to command joy, because that's where he gives you peace beyond your understanding. Even though things are chaotic and things are going on, we declare peace in this house. And then at nighttime, you got to cover your dreams, and you got to make sure, because your dreams is made for the Lord to speak to you. Your dreams is made to get information from angels and from God. Your dreams was not made for the devil to come and penetrate your unconscious mind. Your mind was made for Jesus to come on. That a lot of times God cannot talk to us awake because we're talking too much, or our mind is too much in the natural. And a lot of times in your unconscious mind, that's what God uses to speak to us. So guard your dreams at night time. Before you go to bed, I have a prayer in this prayer book. I'm going to try to get some of these prayers to you all, those who don't have this book. But your dreams have to be covered every single night before you go to sleep. Ask God to cover my dreams. And what you couldn't tell me while I was awake, God, okay, you couldn't tell me why I was awake, God, you're showing me in my dreams. And a lot of times in my dreams is where God speaks to me. Not that I don't hear awake, but something about being unconscious. Oh my God, when God speaks to you, you actually literally really in that place. Come on. Oh my God, it's dreams is almost like you're in a vision. Oh my God, he's speaking to you. He's talking to you. And a lot of times some of these, I won't say the names, but a lot of times I'm walking and I'm with some of these big churches and these big pastors. Sometimes God has me to spend a night with them and talk with them and I'm in their home, and in the dream it sounds like I'm with them a whole week, and I'm going with them, eating at their table and in their dream. And God does that sometimes, because sometimes in person you can't meet some of these people that you wish you could be in their life. You wish they can kind of give you advice, and you wish that they can help you through. And sometimes in your dream, God allow you, okay, my 30 minutes, God would allow you to get importation and get things you need in those times of unconsciousness. Y'all, my 30 minutes is up. Not like I'm out of words, but I am going to do 30 minutes a day. Y'all going to work it. Amanda going to be my time person. We got to get assistance in case she can't show up, but we're going to make sure, because I've been doing an hour and a half. Oh my God. My God. I know that's a miracle right there. I love everybody, and I pray your strength, that you have got something out of these 30 minutes. And I pray that you will take a lot of what I'm saying, and you will watch. You know, if you got a ring on your finger right now, take it off. If you got old furniture in your house, go pray over it right now in the name of Jesus. And we'll talk more about that tomorrow. I love everybody. Thank you everybody for coming on. I'm humbled that you come to be with me, and I really thank you for spending time with me in prayer. I hope I said something to encourage you. Amen. Bye-bye.